Hello YouTube, Clydesight here with an interesting video about audio technology, and this time we're talking about something that's not particularly vintage. I think this dates from the 21st century. It's a Sony CFD 110 combination unit. I guess we would call it a boombox. It has a CD player here, radio, AM and FM, and two tape decks, dubbing and a regular tape deck. It has a microphone input and earphone, stereo earphone output, AM and FM, and tuning, of course. It has volume and tone and a button called bass boost, which is a very big deal for Sony, and no balance control. And a little red pilot light to tell you that it's turned on. And right now I've got it set to the CD, so it's turned on. A fellow participant in cardiac rehab was talking about he had the player and it didn't work, and he didn't know what to do with it. He said, what do I do with it? Should I just throw it out? Does anybody repair these things anymore? And of course, being in love with audio electronics, I could not resist the temptation to offer to try and repair it. I didn't know if I could do it or not, because I'd love to see how they made the unit. Now, when I got the unit, there were some serious issues that he wanted me to address. First that I noticed was the CD was funky. It wouldn't work with the play button. You had to push the pause button, and that got the play button going. The other thing was the stop button wouldn't work. So once you got it started, you couldn't stop it. The only way to stop it would be to pop open the top. There was a dent here in the speaker grill, and that tells me that something happened to the unit. Neither cassette unit would work. You could get it to rewind a little bit or fast forward a little bit, but in play it wouldn't work at all. The whole thing was also very dusty, so it must have been kept in a garage or something. I don't think he's used this for quite a long time because something happened to it. So this video is going to be how I restored this unit. What we're looking at is the cleaned up unit, because Sony did a very nice job in engineering this machine. We're going to take a look at this. We're going to see the restoration. We're going to see all the components that are inside this unit. And then we're going to take it for a test spin, because it sounds wonderful and everything does work. Keep watching the video. To get to the mechanism of the Sony CFD 110, you need to take a bunch of screws out of the case, and the depth of the case is so great you need a very long Phillips head screwdriver to do that. The actual length of the shaft has to be close to 7 inches. But once you've got the screws out, you can start lifting out the front of the case. And to do that, you have to release the cassette doors, and then it will slide out like this. Now, I'm being very careful here because this is the wiring for the speakers and it plugs into the board right here. Once I take this plug out, I can take this whole front mechanism, which is just really the speakers and doors, and put it aside and get to the inside of the machine. Now, although there are a number of screws here, there's actually only four that you need to remove, which is here in the corners, 1, 2, 3, 4. And this plugs into a board, the amplifier board, which is located here, and will lift right out. Once this lifts out, if I needed to work on the CD player, I can remove some screws here and get this out. The cassette mechanism is out of the case, and obviously there are two mechanisms here and they're almost completely identical. This is the playback only unit. This is the record playback unit. And while we have it out, let's take a look at the features. Here you have the record playhead on the playback unit. This is also the unit that controls the dubbing, and it will do regular as well as high speed dubbing. This is the record unit. Here is a magnetic erase head, and here is the record playback. And we can be sure of that by just simply putting it into play, and you see that the erase head does not go forward. But if we take it and put it into record, You see, it goes forward. Most of this mechanism is plastic, and there are a number of gears here that drive the mechanism. So we'll look at here, we'll look at the mechanism here. All right, we're now focused in. We'll look at fast forward. And notice how this transfer gear comes over and runs through this idler gear to the take-up table. Now we'll look at it in rewind. And notice that this transfer gear comes over to this side and works the rewind table. In play, the transfer gear does not shift at all. Now, this does have a mechanical pause. And it has an auto shutoff, but the auto shutoff only works during playback or recording. There is no cue or review. The control keys are removable. They have a little fork that they sit in. There's a little axle here, and if you just pull it out slightly, you take the whole mechanism out. So I'm doing that because I'm going to be working on the machine and these keys get in the way. They're also numbered so that if you get them mixed up, you can put it back together in the proper order. To work on the mechanism, it is necessary to take out the recording amplifier board. And here is the record play switch. And the motor mounts to a connector here. The set of heads for the record playback plug in here, and the set of heads for the playback only dubbing side of the deck plugs in here. And this is an AC bias machine. We have an AC bias coil here. The board is held by several screws. There's four of them in here, and it has little tabs from the mechanism itself to help center it properly. With the amplifier unplugged and completely removed, we can see the entire mechanism. There's a little bit of metal for these plates here, but most of this is plastic. Everything is driven by a single motor here, so it has a two-step pulley on it. The upper step of the pulley from the back runs this belt, which runs this capstan flywheel. And the lower step of the pulley runs a belt here that runs this capstan flywheel. So both capstans are always turning. This clear plastic piece here is for the record play switch. It comes out by removing this screw. And so we're going to do that because I need to replace all the belts here. They're very loose. To change the belts, I have to remove the capstan thrust plate. And I will have to do the same thing with the motor side of it. And it's held in by a screw that goes through this hole here. But it also has two plastic locking tabs. So it's a little tricky to get out, but once you get it out, it comes off like that. And this reveals all the belts. Here's the capstan belt, and here is a secondary belt that drives the fast-forward rewind idler. And there are a bunch of little gears in here again for transferring the motion. So I have to remove this belt first, and then I can remove the lower belt and replace them. I have the motor out. It's located here on this plate, and this is the underside of the mechanism with all the back plates removed. You can see the two capstan flywheels are actually made of plastic. And this is the gearing mechanism that works the take-up drive, and here is the automatic shutoff feature. There's a groove cut into this gear, and that works with the automatic shutoff and also with the pause control to stop the automatic shutoff. So here's the plastic capstans. They don't come out because there's a locking collar on the other side that prevents them from coming out. It's very hard to do. Notice how loose they are in the bearings. So they're very dependent on the back bearing, which is located here on the plate. Before I put the belts in, I want to show why I was repairing this machine. There's a little white gear here that runs the take-up drive during the playback and recording features. And this gear is on a plate that has a tiny fork, which you can't see in the video. That fork rides on a plate, which is molded into this black plastic back plate. Somehow, that fork got out of the slot it belonged in, and so this gear was not able to move. but it is now freed and put back into the proper place. So when I put it into play, do you see how it's moving just slightly? And that's very necessary, because as this turns, it turns the take up. And when it's out of the way, this can turn for the fast forward and rewind, and it won't bother with the take up clutch. I've got the mechanism all put back together with the new belts, and without power, it's very hard to know how effective this is, but there is one way to test it mechanically, and that is to put the machine into either rewind or fast forward and do it on both sides and turn the spindles. So take a look. I'll put it in fast forward here, put it in fast forward here. Now watch this spindle and this spindle. When I turn this by hand, watch this one. You can see that this one is turning. Now the reason it's turning is because this is going through the belt to the capstan flywheel. The flywheel is going to the motor. The motor is turning to the capstan flywheel here, and that capstan flywheel is turning this spindle here. So if you can do it by hand like this, it means your belts are nice and tight. They have to be tight to a certain extent, but not tight to the point where the machine can't stall out if there's a problem. Now I've switched this to rewind. Now watch this spindle here, and you can see that it's turning that. Now if we go the other way, watch this spindle here, and you can see it's turning. So this means that the mechanism is nice and tight, and it should play and rewind and fast forward and do everything exactly the way it was originally designed. Well, I have the mechanism back in the case and it's ready to go, and I've got the speakers out because I have to do some work on the case. There's a dent in one of the speaker grills I want to try and get out, and it needs to be cleaned. But one thing that's a good thing about that was when I took the speakers out, look at this dust. Look at all this dust that's on here. It needs a good cleaning. And what's also interesting is that these speakers have little tiny whizzer cones. So I've got my cassette here, and this is my Sinfonia Felina cassette. And I can play this on YouTube with no problems because I composed and created it. I own it. So we put the tape in, drive one. And let's see if we can get it to work. We'll just put it on play. So there it is in play. It's fast forwarding. It's rewinding. So that's all fine on that side. Let's see about this side. That's all working. There's the rewind, there's the fast forward. Here's the rewind. So that's all working just fine. So I know that the cassette system works and it plays very well. And I've already done a wire flutter test, and it's on speed. There's no problem with it at all. So the next thing to do is find out what's going on with the CD player, because that needed help. Let's take a look at that. The CD player had a couple of problems that I needed to address, one of which is this spring, which you can see here, that's supposed to make the door pop open. Well, the spring kept sliding out, kept falling out of the machine. So I said, that can't be allowed to continue. And it looked like maybe a piece or something that was supposed to retain it is missing. But what I did was I made a new spring for it, which is located in here, and just made it out of piano wire using the standard pipe organ technique of pallet spring design. And that is working just fine. This is Forestdale, Tone Poems Inspired by Nature. And it's my own CD, it's my own creation. Put it right there in the machine. Close it down. Now this is where it gets funky. This is the indicator here. And it found that there are 12 tracks, which is correct. Now if I press play, nothing's going to happen. When I started working on the machine, sometimes the play worked, sometimes it didn't. And the stop button didn't work at all. So I got the board out and I cleaned it. That's about all I could do with it. I think the controller has given itself a lobotomy. But it will work. All you have to do is press pause, and then it goes to track one. And then you can press pause again. Of course, it will pause. Then you press stop, and it goes back and realizes it has 12 tracks and tells you how much is on there. And if you press play, it has no idea what to do. But you press pause again, and it goes to track one, and it will sit there until you hit pause again. And you can skip tracks. So that's all working. Then there's some water sounds there. You have to hit the back thing twice because that's the way it counts. And the stop works. So the CD is playing, it's just kind of funky. So the next step is I'm going to clean up the speakers, and I'm going to clean up the front case, and I'm going to put it back together.